Dear students, today the topic of our lecture is fluxional organometallic compounds. And these fluxional organometallic compounds, they are also known as non-rigid compounds. So the phenomena is also known as structural non-rigidity or stereochemical non-rigidity. So as you know, non-rigidity means flexible. So we will discuss about the fluxional organic compounds in this lecture. Now, when a molecule exists as two structures with comparable stability and are separable, if the two compounds they are separable and they have the stability and they can be distinguished, so the molecule is called as stereochemically rigid molecule. So the two molecules, they can be separated. They have their independent existence. It means they are stereochemically rigid molecules. While the ability of a molecule to undergo fast and reversible change. So if the two, one molecule or one compound can exist in two or more forms, and if the change in between the two forms or more forms is very fast and the changes are reversible from one type of configuration into other, and which depends upon the temperature. As we decrease the temperature, the change will slow down. The rate of the change will slow down, and as we increase the temperature, the change will be fast. So these kind of molecules, they are known as stereochemically non-rigid molecules. So again, I am repeating, what is the difference between stereochemically rigid and stereochemically non-rigid molecules? So stereochemically rigid molecules, they exist in two or more structures, but they are not in equilibrium and their change is not very fast. The change is not very fast and they are actually separable. So they can be synthesized. They are stable compounds. The two compounds which are the two structures for a molecule, the change is not very fast, so that they can be separable and can be synthesized. So these kind of molecules, they are known as stereochemically rigid molecules, while the molecules with fast and reversible change, they are known as stereochemically non-rigid. They are flexible kind of molecule. Okay, now we will study some changes, some kind of changes in molecules, where you will find that the molecules or substance will having more than one structural formula. So how can we differentiate them? Like in case of isomerization. So isomerization is the transformation of one molecule to another molecule. So as you can see that this is a molecule where the double bond is present here, and this can isomerize to this molecule, and here the double bond is present here. The compound is changing, but these two compounds, their energy is different, and this change is not very fast. So this compound can be separable. This is one compound and this is the another compound. So these two compounds, they are separable and they exist actually because the change is not very fast. So these kind of molecules, they are known as non-rigid molecules. And this intramolecular rearrangement is, it's sometimes also called as isomerization. So isomerization and intramolecular rearrangements, in these processes the two structures are entirely different and their energy is entirely different, so they are separable and they are actually, they are stereochemically rigid molecules. So now if we see the phenomena of resonance, in resonance The movement of electrons is there. Only the electrons moves. Here the bonds are moving. Here the only the electrons moves. So two resonating structures. I have shown the structures of benzene. So these two resonating structures, they actually don't exist. They are not the true structures. So these are not the true structure. They are the delocalization of electrons. So it is not a kind of stereochemically non-rigidity, because here these molecules, they don't exist actually. These resonating structures, they don't exist. So resonance is entirely different from that of stereochemically non-rigid molecules. Now the third kind of reaction which we will study is the tautomerism. So tautomerism, the two structures are in dynamic equilibrium. So these are the two structures which are in dynamic equilibrium with each other. But you can see that these two structures, they are having the entirely different groups. So these isomers, they are interconvertible. The two isomers have different structures, but these have the different structures, as it has two keto groups and it has one keto and one OH group. So this is the enol form and this is the keto form. So because these two are entirely different, but they are in equilibrium with each other, and this kind of phenomena is known as non-rigidity. This is stereochemically non-rigidity because these are interconvertible. And but the difference you will see with the fluxionality. Here the two structures are, the two molecules are entirely different, and they have the different physicochemical properties, but are stereochemically non-rigid molecules. Now if we see the term fluxionality, this fluxionality is the phenomena in which the molecules are in dynamic equilibrium. Again, in fluxionality also, the molecules are in dynamic equilibrium, but the difference is that the molecules are equivalent in terms of structure, bonding and energy content. And these are also called as non-rigid molecules. Now you can see the difference between these two. This is the example of PF5, and you can see that there are two kinds of fluorine atoms with this PF5. So two are axial, which are denoted by the red one, and the others are equatorial, which are denoted by the green ink. So you can see that the position of this axial and equatorial fluorine atoms will be exchanged so fastly that these fluorine atoms, they are not distinguished. So you can see that this is the trigonal bipyramidal geometry, and this trigonal bipyramidal geometry will convert into square pyramidal geometry. You can see that these F atoms move towards here, and these F atoms, they move towards here. So the intermediate state is square pyramidal, and then you will find the other arrangement which is having the axial fluorine atoms, they go to the equatorial position, and the equatorial position fluorine will go to the axial position. So in this way you can find that I have shown these fluorine atoms to distinguish the axial and equatorial fluorine atoms, but actually they are the same. All the fluorine atoms are the same. So this molecule is similar to this molecule. So you can see that, so their bonding is similar, their energy content is similar, and their structure is also similar, because all are fluorine atom. So for our convenient, we have changed the color of these fluorine atoms. So this trigonal bipyramidal geometry again converts into trigonal bipyramidal geometry, and this equilibrium is so fast that it cannot be detected easily. So this kind of phenomena is known as fluxionality. Actually, this kind of phenomena for five coordinated compounds is known as Bayley pseudo rotation, which you have already been studied in MSc first semester. So this is Bayley pseudo rotation, where you will find that the molecular formula, the structure, this molecule is equivalent to this molecule. These two molecules, they are equivalent. So these are equivalent, these are having the same energy, these are having the same structure. So this is called as actually flux unity, and these molecules are also called as non-rigid molecules. Now we will see the difference with the tautomerism, and you can see that here the because the compounds are entirely different. This is the enol form and this is the keto form. So due to this difference, these two will have the different physicochemical properties. So it is not a fluxional molecule because these molecules are entirely different. But these molecules are indistinguishable. If all the fluorine atom can be represented by only red, then you can find that this is equivalent to this molecule. So this kind of phenomena is known as fluxionality. So this fluxionality term was first coined by Doering and Roth in 1963. So he has coined the term fluxional, and stereochemical non-rigidity was coined by Muterides in 1965, and while the F.A. Cotton in 1968, he has given the term stereochemical non-rigidity to tautomeric and fluxional molecules. So he has given the term to both kind of phenomena, that is stereochemical non-rigidity. Now we will study the different kind of geometries which are showing the stereochemical non-rigidity, or we can say this is a kind of fluxionality. So first we will study the four coordinate complex, and you have already studied about the atomic inversion in the in MSc first semester. So this is a kind of atomic inversion, like the case of ammonia. So in case of ammonia, this is having the pyramidal structure. This will be the N and these are the H. So this pyramidal structure first go to the planar structure. This is an intermediate, and this intermediate then again converts into pyramidal structure. So you will find there's these two structures. If all the substituents are similar in case of pyramidal geometry, then you will find that this structure is in dynamic equilibrium with this structure, and these structures are actually same structure. So this is known as atomic inversion. So their energy is same, their structure is same, the bonding is same. So this is known as the fluxionality in four coordinated complexes. Now the fluxionality in five coordinate complexes, I have already discussed, that is known as Berry pseudo rotation. So through with the help of this PF5, we can explain the fluxionality in five coordinated system. Now six and higher coordinated system. So in six coordinate or higher coordinated system, actually there is cis and trans fluxionality. Okay, so this is also the temperature dependent process. So it is a kind of fluxionality, and these are the different examples where the coordinate number is 6, 7, 6 and higher, where you will find the temperature dependent fluxionality. Now we will discuss about the classification of fluxionality or fluxional molecules. So which kind of molecules shows fluxionality? So actually we will discuss about four types of fluxional compounds in this section. The first group of compounds which is showing the fluxionality or fluxional behavior is the compound with acyclic alkenes. So in this category we will see the fluxionality of pi allyl groups. So how allyl groups can show the fluxionality. Okay, so now see this compound. In this compound, this allyl group is acting as eta 3, and it is having the eta 3 hapticity because all the three carbon atoms, they are attached to the metal center. And we have already studied in the allylic group in the previous lecture, that the hydrogen atoms which are far away from the metal atom, they are shown by the anti-hydrogens, and those present on the same side of the metal, they are shown by the syn hydrogen atoms, and this is the third hydrogen atom. So I think you can understand that there are three kind of hydrogen atoms in the allylic group. Two are anti, two are syn, and one is the a different kind of hydrogen atom that is attached to this central carbon atom. So you will see that there is actually a dynamic equilibrium between two structures of metal eta 3 allylic complex. So this is eta 3 allylic complex, and this eta allylic complex will convert into eta 1 allylic complex. So this is eta 3 complex, this is eta 1 complex, and again it becomes eta 3 complex. Okay, so in this way you can see that this M will attaches to this carbon atom, so it becomes eta 1. So this is the intermediate state. This kind of change takes place through eta 1 intermediate state, and then you can find that again when it converts into eta 3 kind of this allylic compound, then you will again find that the position of the hydrogen has been changed now. So these anti, they converted into syn, and these syn, they converted into anti-hydrogen atoms. So in this way, this hydrogen atom in this structure, it is at this position, and in this structure it is at this position. So in this way, these two hydrogen atom, they are indistinguishable at room temperature. So they change so fast that we cannot characterize that there are three different kind of hydrogen atoms. Although there are three different kind of hydrogen atoms, but in actually they appears to be two types of hydrogen atoms. One is this and other is this, because this exchange is so fast that it cannot be determined easily. Okay, so this is a kind of fluxionality where you are seeing that these two hydrogen atoms, they become similar kind of hydrogen atoms. Now this is the other group of compounds which are showing the fluxionality, and these are the compounds with sigma bonded cyclic alkenes, and this is also known as ring wedging. Okay, ring wedging, you will find that the position of the ring atoms will be changed that are attached to the metal center. The position of the carbon of the ring, that will change, but the molecule will looks like having the indistinguishable structures. So like this is the case of eta 1 C5H5 and eta 5 C5H5 FeCO2. So here you will find that this is the C5H5 ring, eta C5H5 ring, and this is eta 1 C5H5 ring. So this molecule should have sigma bonded cyclic alkene. So this is sigma bonded cyclic alkene, where you will find that this Fe is attached to this carbon atom via one carbon atom. Actually it should be shown like this, the bond should be shown like this in this structure. So this is the position of bonds. So in this way you can see that in this structure the carbon number 1, I have denoted it as 1 2 3 4 5, all the carbon atoms, 5 carbon atoms. So in this structure this Fe is attached to this carbon number 1. But after ring wedging, you will find that this ring moves like this. So this 5 comes to this, 1 comes to here. So you will find that in this structure, this Fe is attached to the 5th carbon atom. And it can also attach to the 4th carbon atom or 3 carbon atom or 2 carbon atom. But these two structures are having the same energy because they are equivalent. They can't be distinguished. We can't distinguish the number of carbon atom here, because all the groups that are hydrogen atoms, they are same. So this is known as ring wedging. Okay, so this will find in a sigma bonded cyclic alkene compounds. So now this is an another example here. You will find that there are two kind of cyclopentadienyl ligands. One is eta 1 and other is eta 5. So if we have given the number to these rings, so it is eta 5, it is eta 5, it is eta 1 and it is eta 1. So these, there will be the formation of sigma bond and there will be the formation of pi bond. But due to the ring wedging, you will find that this pi number 2 has converted into eta 1. So this is eta 5 and this is converted to eta 1. This is eta 1 and this remains as such, while this number 4 ring, it becomes eta 5, while in this structure it is eta 1. So in this way you will find that, but the two structures, they are indistinguishable because there are 2 eta 5 and 2 eta 1. In this structure also there are 2 eta 1 and 2 eta 5 ligands, cyclopentadienyl ligands are there. So these structures are having the same energy and they are indistinguishable. So it is a kind of fluxionality and this molecule is called as fluxional molecule. Now these are the third type of compounds which are showing the fluxional behavior. So you will find that the compounds with pi bonded cyclic alkenes. But in this case, you will find that the cyclic alkenes have more double bonds that are required to fulfill the 18 electron condition. So metal with poly pi system will show such kind of fluxional behavior and it is known as metal hopping actually. The name of this compound is FeCO3 eta 4 C8 H8. So this is the name of compound. You will find that instead of being C8H8, it is working as eta 4. So actually only 4 electrons are required to for the molecule to be 18 electron system. So the two double bonds, they are not required for the bonding. So it is a metal poly pi system where you will find that only 2 double bonds, they are attached to this iron atom, and 2 double bonds, they are not required, as this will fulfill the 18 electron condition for this molecule. So in this kind of molecule, we will find the metal hopping. So you will find, if we'll denote this double bond with 1 and this by 2, this double bond by 3, this double bond by 4, then you will find that in this structure, this FeCO3 is bind to bond 1 and 2. While in this structure, you will find that this Fe is bind to 1 and 4. And in this structure, this is bind through 3 and 4 double bonds. So in this way, these all the structures, they are equivalent, having the same energy. Only the 2 double bonds, they are participating in bonding, and 2 double bonds, they remain as such. So this is a kind of fluxional behavior of metals with poly pi systems. And they have more double bonds, but bonding will take place through less number of double bonds, and it is known as metal hopping. Now, this is the 4 kind of molecules which are showing the fluxional behavior. So these are generally carbonyls. So this is the group that are metal carbonyls with bridged and terminal carbonyls. So there is exchange between terminal and bridged carbonyls. Okay, so now this is a molecule of CO2CO8 where you will find that all the carbonyl atoms, they are terminal, but this structure is in equilibrium with, you have already studied in the carbonyls in MSc first semester, that this structure is always in equilibrium with this structure, where you will find that 2 carbonyls, they become bridged, and all the 6 the other 6 carbonyls, they are present as terminal carbonyls. So there is the, so this is a kind of fluxional behavior where the terminal carbonyls will exchange with the bridged carbonyl. This is the another carbonyl where you will find that here carbonyl will exchange with this eta 5 cyclopentadienyl ring, and this is a kind of cis trans exchange. So you will find that in this structure, these 2 eta 5 cyclopentadienyls, they are present in the times position to each other, while in this structure they become cis to each other. So this is a kind of cis trans exchange, and it is a carbonyl molecule, and you will find that this kind of exchange will also under the category fluxionality. Now we will study about the dynamic NMR, dynamic nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, which is useful in studying the behavior of fluxional molecules. NMR deals with the chemical environment of a nuclei. So how as the chemical environment of the nuclei changes, their NMR, the position of the peak in the NMR will also changes. So NMR deals with the chemical environment of a nuclei. But in case of many organometallic species, they give pure NMR resonance actually, then would be predicted from their static structure. So the static structure will give how much peaks, the peaks will be lesser than that. So in that case, that is usually because the molecules are non-rigid. So in some cases the molecules are non-rigid, so due to non-rigidity actually the exchange among the sites takes place very fast. So the exchanging of the sites is so fast that they cannot be detected under NMR technique also. So the time scale of NMR is actually 10 to the power minus 1 to 10 to the power minus 6 second. So this time scale, sometimes it may be written as 10 to the power minus 1 to 10 to the minus 9 second. So if any exchange is occurring within this time scale, then that cannot be detected. The environment of that particular nuclei cannot be detected. So the chemical environment might depends upon the exchange of sites. So sometimes when the molecules are non-rigid, in that case the chemical environment depends upon the exchange of sites. So the actual number of peaks, they cannot be observed in the NMR spectra because there is exchange of sites, and exchange of sites is so fast that it is very difficult to detect through the spectra. So exchange of sites can cause change in the NMR spectra. The change in spectrum that depends upon the relative time scale of the NMR and molecular dynamics. So actually the detection, the spectrum depends upon the relative time scale of NMR. If the exchange is very fast, then the relative time scale of the NMR, then it cannot be detected easily. So if we see the speed of dynamics, if it is greater than 10 to the power minus 1 to 10 to the power 6 second minus is inverse, which is for NMR spectra, then it is not detectable in NMR. So or we can say that if the speed of or the time of exchange of groups is faster as compared to relative time scale of NMR, that is 10 to the power minus 1 to 10 to the minus 9 second, then it cannot be detected in the NMR, and actually it occurs at higher temperature. Okay, so I have given an example of this pentagonal bipyramidal carbonyl, and this carbonyl at 25 degree centigrade, it gives only one peak. Okay, yet in its IR spectrum it indicates trigonal pyramidal structure with two different types of carbonyls. Okay, so it means in case of IR, the time scale of IR is 10 to the power minus 12 second. So the exchange is not too fast in case of equatorial and axial carbonyls, that can be detected with the help of IR spectra but not with the help of NMR. Okay, so here the NMR changes, we will do this C13 NMR. So in C13 NMR the time scale is more as compared to the IR spectra. So in case of IR spectra, the time scale is 10 to the power minus 12 second. So the exchange between this can be detectable through IR spectra. If the exchange between the groups becomes slow, that generally occurs at low temperature, then it can be detectable in NMR. So if the time scale of exchange is slow, it is greater than that of the time scale of NMR, then it can be detectable in NMR. So variable temperature NMR is used to study the fluxional behavior. So generally, to study the fluxional behavior, variable temperature NMR is used. So where we can put the temperature range within plus 150 degree centigrade to minus 150 degree centigrade, so that we can study that what is occurring at low temperature and what is occurring at higher temperature. So this NMR, it is known as dynamic NMR. So why dynamic NMR? Because we can detect the behavior of fluxional molecule within a range of temperature, which is helpful in slow down or increase the exchange between the two groups. So this is the advantage of dynamic NMR. If the activation energies of an exchange process, they lie within a range of 25 to 100 kilojoule per mole, and the rate of exchange process lies within a range of 10 to the power minus 1 to 10 to the power 6 second, that can be achieved by changing the temperature in between plus 150 degree centigrade to minus 150 degree centigrade, then this kind of behavior can be detected through NMR. Because if we change the temperature from plus 150 degree to minus 150 degree, then we could achieve an activation energy of exchange of this range and the rate of exchange of this range. So we can detect the behavior in the NMR spectroscopy, because this is the rate of exchange process for NMR spectra, which can easily be detected through NMR spectroscopy. So I have shown this, the NMR spectra, proton NMR spectra, when two site system is there. Okay, so there are two kind of protons with a different environment. So as we decrease the temperatures, this is the spectra on the lowest temperature limit. So if we cool down the temperature of the sample until we see a static spectrum, it is known as low temperature limit. Okay? Or at this low temperature limit, you will identify two sharp peaks for these two different kind of protons. And as we increase the temperature, okay, as we increase the temperature, the rate of exchange will increases, and you will see the spectra will broaden, they start broadening. So peaks start broadening, and as we again increase the temperature, then you will see the coalescence of these two peaks. And at a certain particular, if we warm again, we will see the one peak, these two peaks, they converted into one peak. So here the exchange process become very fast, so that it cannot be detected in the form of two peaks, and this is the high temperature limit. So as we increase the temperature, we can see that between the high, low temperature and high temperature limits, the peaks, they started broadening and coalescence takes place, and at higher temperature, the one peak can be detected through the NMR spectra. So as we increase the temperature of the sample, or we continue to warm the sample, the broadening increases until two peaks coalesces. The exchange rate required to do this, it depends upon the separation of the two resonances at static structure. So if this is the separation of two resonances at static structure, that is at lowest temperature, then broadening of peak, the rate of broadening of peak will depends upon this separation of resonance. Okay, so mu 1 minus mu 2 is equal to delta mu for the static structures. So rate can be determined with the help of this. Okay? On further warming, the rate, now the single peak gets narrower. Okay, the single peaks get narrower and narrower, and we get the sharp single peak, and the rate of the collapsing is now is equals to the pi nu square upon 2 w half. Now what is w half? So if we measure the initial broadening at half peak height in units of hertz and subtract out the natural line width that was present before the broadening, it is known as w half. So when the peak width, when the peak height is half, so the initial broadening, okay, and it is subtracted from the natural line width at the particular peak height, that is known as w half. Again I am repeating, what is w half? The two sharp peaks broadens at the temperature rises. Okay, if we measure this initial broadening, we measure the initial broadening at half peak height in hertz. Okay, half peak height in the initial broadening and half peak height at the natural line width, and if we subtract these two values, then we will get the w half. So the exchange is faster. If the exchange is faster, then the NMR time scale averaged resonance seen. So averaged resonance will seen as a single peak if exchange is faster than NMR time scale, and position of peak at high temperature is actually the weighted average of resonance position at low temperature. So this is the position of peak at high temperature, and it is the weighted average of the resonance position of the peaks at low temperature. So this is the average of these two peaks position. So if we have N1 nuclei resonating at eta 1 and N2 at eta 2 at high temperature limit, the resonance position will be the weighted average. So the resonance position will be the weighted average of these two nuclei. Okay. On cooling the sample, so if we cool the sample from higher temperature to lower temperature limit, okay, the same changes occurs in reverse order. So they start separating, and at lower temperature limit the two peaks will separate. This is known as decoalescence. Okay. Now we can conclude the whole lecture. We have studied in this lecture about the fluxional organometallic compounds, which are generally known as stereochemically rigid molecules. So what are stereochemically rigid molecule? How they are different from isomerization and resonance? The two kinds of stereochemical non-rigidity we have studied is tautomerism and fluxionality, and among these we have to study the fluxionality in detail. Okay, so fluxionality is actually the dynamic equilibrium where the two molecules are equivalent in terms of structure, energy and bonding. So they are known as fluxional molecules. We have studied about the stereochemical non-rigidity in different geometries. We have seen that 4 coordinated, 5 coordinated, and 6 in higher coordinated systems, they show the non-rigidity or fluxional behavior. Then we have studied about the classification of fluxional molecules, and we have studied 4 types of fluxional molecules, that are the pi allylic groups, ring wedging, then metal hopping, and exchange of terminal and bridged carbonyls. So fluxionality in carbonyls we have studied. Then we have studied about the dynamic NMR, the technique that is useful to study the behavior of fluxional molecules. So because the other spectroscopies, they are not used for studying the fluxional behavior, the NMR spectroscopy, because it is showing the dynamic behavior. Dynamic behavior means it could work within a particular range of temperature. Generally, the range of temperature is from plus 150 degree to minus 150 degree centigrade. So within this range, this NMR can works to identify, to characterize the fluxional behavior of molecules. So this is very important. NMR is a very important tool to study the fluxional behavior, because at high temperature the exchange rate will increase, so that the resonance peaks will coalesce to a single peak, while at the lower temperature the exchange process reduces, and it can be detected within the time scale of NMR. So in this way, it is very useful to study the NMR spectroscopy for characterizing the fluxional molecules. So in the next lecture, we will discuss about the fluxional behavior of allylic complex. So how the exchange process takes place within the allylic organometallic compounds, and how we can detect the fluxional behavior of allylic groups. So thank you very much.